I've been talking about, and I'm not going to belabor it by going backwards today, because I want to go right into the meat of what God spoke to me in this word. And I want to title it so you'll get this down and get it correct. And it's about rediscovering the power of one. Okay? Now, our faith has to be incorporated into the culture, or our faith has no expression. If your faith and my faith is not penetrating the culture, then your faith is unto yourself and not unto the Lord. Listen to me today. Can you hear this? If a tree falls in the woods, does it make any noise if you're not there? That's the old statement. Well, the same is true with your faith. If you have faith and it's not expressed into the culture, no one knows you have faith. So no one knows that you believe God. It's not until your faith has a demand put on it that you really know that you have faith. Can you hear that? You don't know that you have faith until a demand is put on the faith and makes you exercise the faith that you say you have. Faith without works, James says, is dead. Can you hear that? So just because you say you have faith, until your faith penetrates the culture, and the culture, the word there is religion. That's what the word culture means. It is religion. Until you, in the faith of Christ, penetrate the culture doesn't know that you have faith. And the way to transport that faith is, and the message of Christ, of the kingdom, and into the culture, the vehicle is evangelism. Evangelism is how we share our faith. It's how we transport. How many of you know when we go to do these turkeys down at Shoppers, I've been telling folks when they go, to go into the store and thank the owner, thank the workers. And go buy a turkey and then give a turkey. Are you hearing me? Because, saints, how many of you know that in a lot of people's mind, God is dead? And due to religion, they've helped make it look like God is dead. Dead religion, the Bible says, by your traditions, vain traditions, you bring to null effect the commandments of the Lord. Matthew says that. How many hear me? Are you there? By your traditions, you've brought to null effect the command. Traditions can be so many things. And the tradition of doing something religious, thinking you're going to move God on your behalf. God's not impressed with your acts. He's not impressed with your doings until your doings has his faith in it. Because the Bible says when the Lord comes back, he's coming back for one thing. He's looking for faith on the earth. Have you heard that? And God's looking for people today who walk in faith, demonstrate faith, talk faith. I, dealing with this issue with the dear lady that's in the hospital right now, I refuse to listen to those reports. And I have said this hundreds of times, and my own daughter, when she had her battle with cancer at 15, I refused to let anybody get around her and speak death. Come on, are you listening? Because the Bible says there's what is in the power of the tongue, life or death. So I choose who wags their tongue to my children. You should choose who wags their tongue towards you. Because either life's in that tongue or death. And you can choose who you want to listen to. When the devil starts talking, resist him and he has to flee. You'll shut his tongue up. Can you hear me today? Now, there's a quote that we have over the door in the Bible school. And in the Bible classroom door there, and it says, the doors of history hinge on extraordinary decisions of ordinary people. Have you here? The doors of history hinge on the extraordinary decisions of ordinary people. Boy, is that powerful. Ordinary people have shaped the world. Have shaped the world. Now, I want to talk to you today on three areas, and I'm going to bring them all together and tie them up in a nice little bow. I want to talk to you today about three areas. First of all, is the life of an oyster. You say, wow, that sounds exciting. I mean, think about it. The life of an oyster. I don't think you'd put it on the next movie screen. Here is the, you never see a cartoon about the life of an oyster. Because the oyster lays on the bottom and just lays there. But oh, how that oyster plays such a role in our culture, in our life. So we can talk about the life of an oyster. I like oysters, by the way, but I'm going to talk to you about it. Where the next thing is where weakness can be an invitation to your greatness. And lastly, the title, how can we discover or rediscover the power of one? So we got three things to look at. The oyster's life, the weakness that's turned into greatness, and then discovering or rediscovering the power of one. Those three pieces, I'm going to fit them together today. Are you here?
Yes.
How many of you, are you here?
Yes.
Some of you need to wake up today, okay? I don't want to pray. I got your offering already so I could just leave. Come on. How many of you here today?
Yes.
Act like you're in church. Act like you're alive.
Amen.
Now, we serve a God who declares in his word, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. Now, have you hear that? My power, God says, is made perfect in weakness. Now, we live in a day where weakness is prevailing everywhere, but everybody's covering it up. Everybody hides weaknesses. Athletes tear their arm, leg, muscles and things, and they put them back on the field because they don't want to look like they're weak. And we live in a culture today over in China for years. I don't know if they still do, but when I've been there several times, I've talked to Chinese pastors and all, one of the things they do is if you're handicapped, they hide you from the public. They don't want you to be visible because they're ashamed of that. Are you listening? And how many of you know today a lot of people don't like weakness? Let's look a little further now. Now, in that understanding, God's power is made perfect in weakness. We serve the God, by the way, in the Bible, we serve the God of Moses, the stutterer, David, the adulterer, Joseph, the dreamer, Elijah, the chicken, Gideon, the quitter, and Esther, the orphan. How many of you could be written into this book? You see, if that's who's in the Bible, isn't it amazing that God chose to use those characters to encourage us? I love the Bible because it doesn't preach about the heroes and heroines of the Bible, only telling us their victories. Now, we like to read just the victory part, but there's a lot of storyline around the victory. Come on. Now, with that in mind, let's talk about the oyster for a minute. He's an amazing character. And you look at the life of an oyster to set the stage for this whole thing that I want to talk to you about. A piece of dirt or sand finds its way past the hard outer protection shell of an oyster, deep into the folds, layers of the heart of the flesh, a little grain of sand finds its way into the oyster itself. You hear me? And in that process, and this piece of dirt, sand, this irritant, this unwelcomed intruder or intrusion becomes in time what we call the costly pearl of great price. Can you hear that? The oyster is the greatest natural cleanser for the Chesapeake Bay. If you'll read, and I live on the bay, so I get pamphlets and papers and things constantly, they will sell you enough oysters to create an oyster bed in your on your property if you live near the water. They're asking you to grow oysters so that you can we can plant more oyster beds all through the bay. Because the oyster beds and the oysters filter the water, cleansing the water out and purifying every bit of water so the water is cleansed by the oyster. When the great settlers that landed in Williamsburg, when they came through the mouth of the Chesapeake Bay in Virginia Beach, their log reports on the ship's log reported that Captain John Smith, when he came through, he was overwhelmed with the size of and the amount of the oyster beds to the point where at low tide they couldn't even come in the Chesapeake Bay. And if you read, you will see that oysters, depleting oysters, destroying oysters, is what's really caused the bay to get polluted or stay polluted. Are you listening to me? So this oyster has a real job. It has a real assignment. Now the oyster itself is transitory, meaning it's temporary blip there on the ocean floor doing its time, and it has a season and it does its period of time of cleansing, and then it passes away or it is captured and shucked. The results of the pain, though, of this piece of sand, it endured, will be cherished, and then it gets passed on to generations and generations after adorning the necks of some of the greatest, most beautiful women on the earth. So the little oyster has an assignment. Yet in that assignment, a test comes, a trial comes, and it gets into the oyster and it rubs the oyster. Now the oyster is not comfortable. The oyster is just not comfortable with that particle. How many of you ever had a spot, a speck in your eye? And how many of you know I had a piece of metal a half inch long went through my eye? Some of you ever had a little piece of sand get in your eye? You think there's somebody in there walking around with cleats. You're whining and crying and you're just wiping it. Think about me. I had a half inch long piece of metal went all the way through. Yeah, that's what I said. Now, in that process, I said to you, what happens is that little oyster produces something from that trial. From that test comes, from a test comes a testimony. From a mess comes a message. Can you hear that? And in that oyster's life, something gets created. Now, I told you some of the prettiest women in the world adorn these. These belong to my wife. They were not hers, they're her mother's. So two beautiful women in my life have wore these pearls. And these pearls, each one of them, is an irritant that got into the soul of an oyster. And because the oyster lived with it, moved with it, came forth something gorgeous and something beautiful. How many of you know that when God puts a little sand in your life, when he puts a little obstacle in your life, how many of you know that that little obstacle has an assignment? And if you'll realize that what God is up to, God is up to making you perfect, because in weakness his power is made perfect, and there's nothing any more perfect than a pearl. My wife and I were in the Caribbean one time with a bunch of us. Mary Jane and Mel were there, and We had a big yacht I'd chartered, and I was taking us all over the place. And so in the morning, I had docked up offshore, close enough to swim to the shore, in a little cove near St. John in the Caribbean. And we anchored there, and it was early in the morning. And Corley and I got up, and we dove off the back of the boat and swam to the beach. And we walked along the beach. Nobody was there. Nobody was up. And there was a little cottage there that someone of the hotels used as a wedding cottage for people who were on honeymoon. And there was nobody there, and we just kind of walked around a little bit. And then it was time, so we got back in the water, and we swam. And because my life's been in the water, I didn't have flippers. She had flippers, so she could keep up. I had a mask on, though, because I wanted to see some things on the bottom. And we were swimming along. We were coming back to the boat, and I saw something flash. And my eyes are very, very sensitive to movement in the water because I fish a lot. So the slightest movement, boy, I can pick it up because I'm thinking it's a fish. So I dive down. My wife's here, and I dive down, make sure it's not a shark. I dive down. And when I'm diving, I see something on the bottom. So I dive down again and go deep. Man, I'm down there. And I grab this thing. Well, what it was a whole string of pearls, of fake pearls, and they were costume pearls. So I took my mask and twisted it and filled it with water, came up gasping, and I was struggling, and I handed her these pearls. And I said, boy, I fought with this oyster for so long. And she put them on and wore them to the boat, and it was a big deal for the rest of our trip that I went down into the deep. See, y'all don't have, you're talking Jacques Cousteau here, you know. I got your attention. You still there? Now, speaking of great women, I have a reason today. Go to Esther chapter 4. I want to just tell you the story. I'll read one verse to you today from here, and I'm going to tell you the story the way it fits. Are you still with me today?
Yes.
We still know the power of an oyster.
Yes.
One oyster can produce 2 and 3 pearls. Now, some of your Pacific oceans can produce in Hawaii and places like Fiji, they can produce the black pearls. Big, giant, marble-sized black pearls. There it is, a picture. There's the pearl inside there. How perfect is that pearl sitting in that oyster? You got to get a picture. That was only a piece of dirt. When God made you, you were just a piece of dirt. But in the oyster of God's hand, in the process of God's hand, when God finished rubbing on you, he opened his hand, and there you were, the pearl of great price. Are you listening to me today? God is still working on some of you. Now, we're talking about great women, so the scriptures gives us a perfect example in Esther chapter 4 and verse 14. And we got to remember now where weakness becomes an invitation to greatness. Like the oyster, we see the power of one. For if you keep silent at this time, Mordecai, who is the uncle of Esther, she is there in front of the king. She's at the palace. Unbelievable story. She is the Cinderella of the Bible. And all of a sudden, she's there. And it says, for if you keep silent at this time, relief and deliverance shall arise for the Jews from elsewhere. But you and your father's house will perish. And who knows but that you have come to the kingdom for such a time as this. And for this very occasion. In the American King James, it says, for if you altogether hold your peace at this time, then shall there be enlargement and deliverance arise to the Jews from another place. But you and your father's house shall be destroyed, and who knows whether you are come to the kingdom for such a time as this. Now, Mordecai is a Jewish man, a believer, Esther is a Jew, she doesn't believe. She's not practicing her Judaism. There is a period of captivity here. And the king there is a wicked king. And the whole time of this is a period of time where Artaxerxes is there, and there's just a horrible setting. And if you were a Jew, you didn't tell it. If you were a Jew, you didn't talk about it. You still there? Now watch this story unfold. When we encounter Esther, there's nothing about her that prepares her to believe that she'll move into greatness. She is the original, as I said, Cinderella. She is alone, unremarkable, and has every disadvantage you could have in society. She's a woman. That wasn't going to work in a male-dominant culture of the day. She was a woman, she was a peasant, and she was of a Jewish background, which she couldn't disclose. So she had nothing going for her. Are you listening to me? Nothing. An outcast. By the way, she had no parents. She had no family except for an old uncle. Still there? Now, she has not been born into the right family. She has not attended the right schools. In fact, there are three distinctive issues she carries with her that are like the sand in the oyster. And they are serious irritants to her ability to reach her potential. So this girl is not in the right place. She's not in the right environment of life. She came at the wrong time because she's born and all the Jews are hiding it. She's born and all the Jews are ashamed of it. She has no family. She is an outcast. She's a woman. We don't want to hear from you. Now, she was beautiful, but her beauty, because beauty is skin deep, was hidden with all of her shame, was hidden with all, because like many of us, there's a pearl inside and the outside shroud is keeping it from being revealed. Now, so many times when we read stories in the Bible, I mentioned it a minute ago, we revel in victory of the outcome. We like the outcome. We talk about Jesus' resurrection. We don't talk about how horrible that cross was. But if you look inside the oyster, there's a real honest picture of our heroes and our heroines in the scripture, because that sand is like David. God had him in an oyster of life. And God was dealing with David to get him to become the pearl that he was supposed to be. Are you listening? The scripture, though, is so good because it doesn't ignore the faults or the shortcomings. Why? I believe the reason is this. So we would hear God say to us, "You can do it too." You know that guy comes out, "You can do it too." Come on. How do you know you can do it? Jesus said, "You can do all things." So God is so good that he brings us to a place that looking at scripture and looking at the characters, we need to see each one of them inside of an oyster. God put Moses in a basket, but it was an oyster. Jonah was in a fish, but it was an oyster. Come on now, are you with me? Daniel was in a lion's den, but it was an oyster. Can I go further? Every one of us is the person that God puts inside of his kingdom, and we're inside the oyster, and there's a work going on, and that work is oftentimes an irritant in our life, and it's rubbing us, and we're fighting the process Because we're about ready to be cracked open and revealed. How many of you know God couldn't have put a prettier piece of jewelry, if you've ever seen black pearls, if you've ever seen big giant pearls, God couldn't have put a better piece of jewelry in an uglier vessel. Come on. There ain't nothing pretty. You can lie. People who study the oyster will probably tell you, oh, that's a beauty. They're not ugly. I love them. I eat them all the time. I can swallow them. Boom, man. My wife and I'll put them on the grill. We'll eat 75, 80 of them ourselves. Look at that picture. How could something so beautiful be hidden in the hand of Jehovah God? And what God is doing with you, nobody can see but only God. And to get it open, you got to pry it open. You got to work on that thing. And if you were looking for something beautiful, you'd pass it by. You'd say that's a piece of junk. You'd kick it over. You'd move it aside. But inside of that is ready to be brought out to something beautiful. Once God takes something that's nothing, He turns it into something. My, 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 my. Oh, I ain't done. Come on a little further. Are you still here?
Yes.
Is God still working on you?
Yes.
You like a piece of dirt?
Yes.
I love you. Jane, nothing but a piece of dirt.
Yes.
A piece of dirt inside of the oyster of Creator God's hand. When God finishes working on you, some of y'all are going to be black pearls. See, somebody said, that's a racist preacher up there. They got black pearls. They got white pearls. My wife's got a whole bundle of pearls I bought her in Korea. And they're little small, ragged ones because they were new, pulled out. They weren't finished. There's all shapes and size pearls. But how many of you know, that's money right there. That's money right there. I can take a little trip on those. You notice they were in my pocket. See, I got to protect them. See, I'm like David. I put them in my sack. And I put them away till they're needed. Like God does. He keeps you in the oyster till He needs you. He keeps you in the oyster till it's time. And He has x-ray vision so He can see inside the oyster. And He looks at you and says, no, they're still a little rough looking. Let that thing bother that oyster a little bit longer till it becomes what it's supposed to be. I believe the reasons that God put it in the Bible this way, that we can see the faults and the shortcomings of people. He wants you to see it and say, you know, you can do this. I know about you, God says. I know your failures. I know about your struggles. None of them have caught me by surprise, saith the Lord. The things that you want no one to know about and that you try to hide even from yourself, they are not obstacles to my love and to my destiny for your future. In fact, I have allowed some of them and those very difficult things, He says, and I'll redeem them to bring about your greater good and your greater blessing. Saith the Lord. These issues in Esther's life became the very platform on which she would stand in deliverance for her nation and her people. My God. We're talking about evangelisms over these last few weeks. How many of you know Esther, this unaccepted, lonely orphan, all of a sudden is now turned the heart of a king. My, 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 my. What were the issues? There are three of them. I said it, and I'm going to say these three and come to the end. Number one was family. Have you heard that? Family was an issue. Esther was an orphan. How many of you know you have issues today? And how many of you know in this issue, Esther was an orphan. Remember, an orphan is one who is born but not raised by their parents. How many of you know there's a lot of people been born again, but they're not raised by their parents? Hello? A lot of people get born again, but they're not raised by their parent because they rebel and run away and they don't find that place and the purpose of God. And then what happens is many times they go around with an orphan spirit on them. Esther had only one thing. She had an old uncle named Mordecai. Orphans are always wondering and wandering. Why me? And woe is me. Hello? Have you know the orphan spirits in the church? People that are always running around wondering, why me? Woe is me. Because they've not identified who their father is. They haven't come to a place to understand spiritual fatherhood. Are you listening to me? The second thing is security. Esther, she was a woman in a man's world. She needed to know she was safe and cared for and protected, and she had nobody but an old uncle. And he wasn't allowed in the palace. He was made to stay outside because he was always fasting. Now, let me help you here. You got to read it. Mordecai would stand at the gate naked and put ashes and sackcloth on him and would be out there fasting for days because Esther told him to go fast with no food, no water for 3 days. So Mordecai's outside the gate. He was bothering people. And Haman, the wicked executor, he was bothered by this guy Mordecai because when he walked out the gate, Haman was walking by and Mordecai was there. Mordecai wouldn't bow to him. No, Haman said, what is this man? Who is? And then it says he held himself because he was so full of pride. He was boasting about how great things were and how he was invited to the king's party, private party. Esther had set it up so he could come. This little woman who was an orphan is now moving into a place called destiny. Her season of being a pearl was coming to the forefront. Are you listening to me? But when the call came for her to come to the palace and step into her destiny, her insecurity became her opportunity. She had nothing to hold her back. How many of you know God's not calling us to survival, but he's calling us to greatness? Too many people today need to realize when, you know, people feel like, nobody likes me. Nobody wants me around. I don't know why I'm island to myself. God takes the solitary and sets them in the family. God wants you to know that all those things are his process of making you into what he wants you to be. Not many mighty, not many noble. God is assembling something that he will get the glory and not man. Can you hear me? The third one is identity. She was a Jew. So she was an orphan. She was insecure. And she had an identity crisis. She was a Jew like many times in history. That wasn't a very popular person or nation to be part of. Like being a Christian today. From reading her story with her being in exile, she was estranged from her faith. Mordecai, her uncle, had warned her many times not to tell anybody she was a Jew. Now, she's a Jew in the palace. If the king knew it, she even touched the top of the scepter of the king. If you ever did that, you were killed. She had the heart of the king. All his concubines, he chose Esther. God chose Esther before the king did. You see, God chooses you when you don't think you're very choosable. You see, God knew you from your mother's womb. And when you were in there, God chose you. Before you came out, He knew who you'd be. He knew what your name would be. You say, well, why did I have to go through all this? And why do I got all these problems? And oh, my God, I've been married and divorced and life. And that old oyster's worked on you. Now, you can die an oyster, and the pearl will die with you. If you let the process kill you, it will kill your potential. If you let the process of God kill you, it will kill your potential. But if you will just see like God sees and says, there's a pearl inside of the oyster. One of these days, you're going to leave the oyster and be on the neck of greatness. You won't be the head. But you'll be on the neck of greatness. Wow. Poor old Mordecai, man, he was in trouble. The culture today, come on. How do you know the culture today is having a hard time? Having a hard time with those around us that have faith in God. They just have a hard time with these Bible-toting, gun-toting Christians. What are we? Unredeemable. What's the other word? Deplorable. You know why? Because all they see is the oyster. They don't see the pearl that's inside of the process. Aren't you glad that God didn't look at the oyster? But He looked inside and said, there's a pearl being made in there. I'm going to keep this one. Aren't you glad that God didn't put you in the bushel basket and just toss you to the side? But that you were that oyster that had that was a pearl being made. And God said, take it. David had 7 brothers. And God said, no, I want that one. Because that oyster had one thing inside. It had a pearl. And nobody else but the prophet could see it. How many of you know you need prophets today that can see the value that God has put on you and that God has in you? Because if you don't have those prophets around you, you'll think that you're of no value, you're of no use, you're of no good. But a prophet says, hold up, take that oyster, bring it over here. There's a pearl being made. Creator God is at work. Don't you throw that oyster away. Wow. But each of these issues that Esther went through, they were her sand. It was her oyster. To give her a platform to be mighty, to be used mighty by God, to rescue the people and the nation of Israel. Is it possible? Is it possible that we could read Esther 4:14 again? Could you go back there? I said it a minute ago. God wants to turn your mess into a message. God wants to turn your test into a testimony. Can you hear that? You see, when you're told you're going to die, when you're told that your heart or your life or your cancer or whatever is going to take your life, that's a test. But you need to know that on the other side is your testimony that God took me through the process to make me a pearl of great value. When nobody wanted to be around me, nobody could take a chance. Because I was a risk. Criminals wanted to kill me. Cops wanted to arrest me. Nobody wanted to be around me. I was a hot potato. Nobody wanted to be near me. But God. God put me in a house that had the X-ray vision of the anointing of the Holy Spirit and could see by the prophetic. And when my rough-looking oyster rolled down to the front of the church, the prophet said, "Yea, yea, saith the Lord, shut that one out because that one's got a pearl being made inside of it." Not every oyster has a pearl. Wow. For if you keep silent at this time, Rock City Church, born again, blood washed, born again believer, listen to me. For if you keep silent at this time, I'm Mordecai today. I'm the uncle today. You got to listen to me, Esther. I'm going to talk to you, Esther. I'm talking to you, Esther. Listen to me. For if you keep silent at this time, relief and deliverance shall arise for the Jews from somewhere else. But you and your father's house will perish. And who knows? Who knows? But that you have come to the kingdom for such a time as this. And for this very occasion. I'm old Mordecai. I'm fasting and I got ashes and sackcloth on me. And I'm outside of the gate and I'm there begging on God. I'm there before God and I'm saying, "Oh God, use this new millennial generation. Use this group of Esthers, oh God. Raise them up. Let the king find them favorable. Give them favor with God and man. In the business place, in the school systems, in the bank systems, in the media." Remember, we started with a quote. "The doors of history hinge on extraordinary decisions of ordinary people." We're sitting here today. Listen to this. This is very prophetic. We're sitting here today, 10 days from a terrifying day, ordinary people making extraordinary decisions like Esther that will affect the nation and the people of God. 10 days. 10 is the number of redeemed church with responsibility according to our ability. 10 is in the book of Revelations. Jesus held the church. Are the churches responsible for rejecting his word and his will? 10 commandments were given by God to teach man how to love him and to love each other. 10 virgins were waiting for the bridegroom. Like Esther, the time is now, such a time as this. With 7 billion people on the earth, what business do any of us have thinking our individual lives matter to God and his purpose? I'm just an ugly oyster sitting on the bottom of the sea of humanity. How could God use me? And all of a sudden, the hand of the oysterman reaches down, pulls your life up off the bottom of the sea of humanity. And he looks at it. Because of the anointing, he sees inside. Uh-oh, this is a precious one. Don't open this one. Set this one aside. because when this, put it in the right water, take care of it, because the water of the word needs to wash over this particular oyster. Because this oyster, if it sits there and it sits in the water and it takes time, something is rattling down inside of there. Something is inside of that oyster. It ain't like them other oysters. This oyster over here, it don't have the same sound. But this oyster, you want to take care of it. This is an oyster that's got something inside of it. Why did God choose you? Of all the oysters in the ocean, ain't very lovely. Kind of queer shaped, weird shaped. Some long, some short, some fat. Reaches down and says, this one? Oh, this one is special. One day you're just walking, doing your own little thing, doing your own little game. And the hand of Jehovah reaches down and grabs that old oyster. Ooh. Starts pushing you, sends the water to wash you, till all of a sudden your little oyster rolls over, moves along with the tide, and all of a sudden, there you are, one day, at an altar, and God cracks that thing open, and the world says, oh my God, how could something so beautiful have been hidden in something so ugly? We have sinners to vote for. And I have a feeling the hand of God has reached down. And he shook one of them. And he said, this oyster has got a pearl being made inside of it. Amen. 7 billion people. My. So I'm old Mordecai today. I'm your uncle. In the black community, they got more uncles than you can imagine. I'm your uncle today, and you're Esther. And like Mordecai said, there are no angels coming to deliver the nation. No plagues this time. No fire falling from heaven this time. Instead, Esther, it's just you for such a time as this. Stand to your feet today. Have you say with me, Lord, I'm just an old oyster lying on the bed of humanity. But how is it, God, you see something beautiful? As an old song we used to sing, he made something beautiful of my life. All my confusions, all of those things he understood, because there's something beautiful he made of my life. How many are glad today that God made something? How many are glad that God's making something? How many say, Lord, don't let the process be the reason I default. Don't let the process cause me to run away from the purpose, God, that you started from the beginning of time. How many of you understand not every oyster has a pearl in it? Yeah. Humanity is covered with oyster beds. And God, by his sovereignty, picks up, let's take that oyster. Let's put that oyster right here. something only can be explained by the Spirit of God. He chooses whom he decides to choose. Are you listening to me today? You were just an old rough oyster. But if he brought you into the kingdom, he knows there's a pearl being made. It's you. And like Esther, we need to say, Lord, thank you. We have a responsibility today to go out of this house for such a time as this and share the gospel, share the good news, witness to people, tell people that Jesus is alive and Jesus does miracles and Jesus wants to save them and touch them. Can you hear me today? I'm going to turn y'all into oystermen. You're going after oysters. And in the oysters, you might bring some into the house, but they ain't got a pearl in them. Out of the four seeds, only one seed made it. Out of the four seeds that were sown, only one made it. Not everybody that says, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of God. This is a process of God making pearls. Wow. And then I love what they do. They string them together. How do you know God found you, Antonio? He found you, Tavon. Tiana, you're on here. Wow. 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 Mark, Rosa, Emily. You even got one for you, Emily. A little teeny thing over here, but it's there. Wow, there's an old pearl here. That's mine. Lord, thank you. Tie us together, Lord. Make us a string of pearls. Make us who you want us to be, Lord. May we stop resisting the process and yield to it so we can become all you want us to be. I want to pray for you right now. Heads are bowed. No one looking around. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray right now that you take the canopy off. Take the lid off. The lid of restrictions. The lid that's holding back, God. Those that desperately need you and want you. Those that know they can't live a double dual life, they've got to live their life for you, God. Those that are under a process today, oh, some of you, I know the process, but you got to remember Moses, God pulled him up. He stuttered. David was, involved in infidelity. God takes the people like Daniel and people like Gideon, who's he's a quitter. Elisha was a chicken. He ran from Jezebel and hid in a cave. God has a process to make you. He wants to make you all that you're supposed to be. We're praying for you right now. We're praying for you right now. Praying for you right now. If you're in this room here today, this message was designed for you. If you're watching there on the live video stream around the world, this message is for you right now. I'm old Mordecai right now, and I'm telling you, Esther, you were born for such a time as this. If you're an orphan like Esther, you need to get home. You need to get right with God. You need to get back in God and give God everything in your life. I want to pray for you right now. If that's you, no one looking around, just pray this prayer with me. If that's you, I want to pray with you. I'm saying, God, open their eyes. Touch them today. Help them understand that it is your mighty hand that is at work in their life. And if you're that person, you say, Pastor, pray for me today. I want that prayer. I really want God to work in my life. I want God to do all that He wants to do in my life. I want Him to be King of my life. If that's you right now, slip your hand up right where you're standing, and I'll pray with you. Just hold it up. Say, it's me, Pastor. Hold it up. I'll pray. Yes. Anybody else? Hold it up. Yes. I see your hand there. Anybody else? Hold it up. I'm going to pray for you now. Just say, it's me. I'm going to do this right. I'm going to get it right. Yes, ma'am. I see that hand. Anybody else? Yeah, I see that hand. Anybody else? Put it up. Anybody else? Put it up. This is the best prayer you're going to get today. It's the best. Don't fight what God's trying to do. He's trying to make you into the pearl of great price. Hold your hand up. Hold your hand up. Don't be ashamed. Hold it up. Yes, I see that extra hand. Those with your hands up, come here quickly so I can pray with you. Come right down here right now. Quickly, quickly, quickly. Just move. Just say, I've got to go. Got to go. Get out of your seat. Come. Come on. Come on. That's right. Come on. Back in the back. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Now. 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 Just come down. Come on. Get some of these women up here. Counselors, get up here. Need some ladies. Get with these ladies. Come on. There's another lady coming right there. Right there. On this side, ladies. Right here, sweetheart. Come right over here. Father, we thank you. We thank you for these lives. We thank you for these that are here today, that God, you're touching right now. Father, I pray my best prayer. Bless them. Open their eyes. Open their hearts. God, let them be restored and refreshed. And Lord, let them see that this is the day. This is the hour. This is the time for them to get it right with you, to live for you, to walk with you, to run after you, that all the days of their life, they'll live for you. God, I bless them. I pray for them. I pray for the blessing of God over their lives. Fill them with the Holy Spirit. If they need to be baptized, God, baptize them. Lord, whatever they need to do, let the fullness of God radiate on and in their lives. Fill them right now, God, with the Spirit, and touch their lives. Put your hand out this way to me. I bless you right now. Father, I bless your people. And I pray that, God, those that are in a process, those that are in a process, now I have a word of knowledge. Some of you that are in that process, you're trying to stop the process. And some of you are trying to get out of the oyster. That is the grace of God holds you, holding you in his love, even though he's dealing with you. Stop fighting the dealing and let God finish the work that he begun. Let God finish what he's begun in your life. Let God finish that work. Let him finish it today. My God, let him finish that work today. Now I'm going to open this altar up one more time. Those of you that are here and you're born again, you're saved, but the process has been a little heavy lately and there's been a tendency for you to try to get out of the oyster. But today you understand the revelation of the oyster is where God has you to make you all you're supposed to be. But if that's you today, we want to pray an extra prayer for you. So if you're there, just get out of your seat and come and stand right here in the middle. Just come right here in the middle. Quickly, quickly, quickly. Just quickly. Just don't take all that time. Just come quickly. Say, excuse me, I got to do this. I need God to do something. That's right. Come on, come on. Pull them over here. Pull them over here. Come on. Joe, help me. Got to move them around. You can't stand there. Come on, help. Get them right up front. 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 Pack them in. Pack them in. Bring them in. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. They're coming, they're coming. Come on, this is a word from God. Come on, come on, in the back here. You coming up here, get in here. Get in here, sweetheart. Come on, get in here, get in here. Come on, come on. Father, in the name of Jesus, put them up in here, put them up in here. Those that are getting prayed for the altar call, move them over to the right and left a little bit. I want them in the middle here. I want them in the middle. Look at me, look at me, look at me. Now listen to me, every one of you. All of the folks in this church have either been there or they're going to be there. You're not an elite group or special or a problem. But life sometimes in that oyster gets real tough. Now remember something. In an oyster, the bigger you get, the harder the problem is, because you're about ready to be revealed. So sometimes when you're tiny little teeny and you're in a big oyster, ain't no problem. But when you start growing and you start getting bigger in that same oyster, there ain't no room in there. And the oyster wants you out. But the oyster can't let you come till God finishes making you. Do you understand this? So where you're at right now is in the hand of God. He has you like the pearl in there. And you are absolutely the delight of his heart. But because the oyster cracked open, you saw an exit. And when you run away from the thing that God's doing, you can't ever get back in the oyster. Ever. You can't ever get back in. When a water stream is flowing and you get out of the water, you can never get back in the water where that stream was. Do you understand that? Stay in the oyster. Stay in the hand. Stay in the hand so that God can finish the work. And when it's time, he reveals. And you are then the pearl of great price. Can you believe that? Will you make that commitment? Stop trying to get out of the oyster. All right, put your hand out this way for me. I'm going to pray for you. Elders, come on, re-around them. Get around those folks. Just pray with them. Just get around them. In front of them, behind them. I don't care where you get. Just pray. Father, in Jesus' name, I bless them today. I pray that the oysters would seal back up. And that, Lord, they'll not try to get out of the process. But they'll accept the process as the hand of God. At the hand of God. And they'll yield to it. They'll say, thank you, Lord. It is your doing. It is not the doing of man. It is the doing of God. And when you're finished, I'll then come forth at the right time, at the right season, for the right reason. And I'll be the pearl of great price. I got one last thing to say to you. The audience here. Now stay in that oyster. Do you hear me? Go back to your seats, please. I'm going to bless the audience one more time. Joe, put me two plates here. I want you to do something today. Put me some plates up here, just a couple, quickly. Look at me, look at me. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to do something extra. Now, we have a lot of people coming. We have a convention coming. I don't want to get up in the convention and have to be spending every service pulling to get the money that it cost us to bring in the guest and do what we do so that you get blessed. All of it so that you get blessed. I can hear them guys preach all the time because I preach with them. So I don't need just to have, I'm bringing them because you need to hear them. Have you understand that? And here's what I want you to do. I want you to give today, and I want you to be extremely generous, okay? And we're going to do this quick. We do it all the time. If you're a visitor, it will not take 5 minutes, but this is what we're going to do. We're going to give extra today. So before you run away and try to escape the thing God's doing, just listen for a minute. God may want to use you. Just hold still. Here's what I want you to do. I want every one of you to think right now and pray. And say, just pray in a minute. And you're going to ask, Lord, what do you want me to do, Lord? And then I'm going to come and I'm going to ask for you to make a commitment and bring it in today. I need you to give it in today. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray over the people of God. I tell people all over the world what a great people you are. I tell people all over the world what a great church you are. Because I believe that in my heart. You're just a bunch of oysters, but I know there's a pearl inside them. And I know they're a price, pearl of great price. And I know that God is going to finish the work that he's begun in each of us. He's not done yet. He's going to finish it. So we're here today, and we're going to bless the kingdom in advance so that we can celebrate together How many of you hear me? We're going to celebrate together. So next week during convention, I'll get to enjoy it as well. Because I'll know the bills are covered and we're taking care of what God wanted to do. Can you hear me today? All right. Now, I know God spoke to you. Here's what I want you to do. Those of you that will commit to give $1,000, I want you to raise your hand right now. Just $1,000. I want you to raise your hand. I'm going to count them quick. Hold them up. Hold it up. Hold it up. Anywhere. Hold it up. This is how you get blessed, saints. This is how you get blessed. Don't tell me you're blessed when you can't be generous with God. Come on. Hold your hand up. Hold your hand up. Let me see your hand. Anybody else? $1,000. Okay. Mark, are you giving me peace sign or are you holding up one? Okay. Okay. Yeah, you got five. I'll take that five. Okay. Okay. Hold your hand up. Hold your hand up. Okay. What did you say? Oh, I got one here. Okay. One, two, three, four, five. Who else? Is there one more? I thought there were six. Maybe I'm hearing things. All right. $500. How many of you will give $500 so that we can get this bill? The goal is to get to $12,000. That's what our bill is. We need to get that so I don't have to struggle with this for the rest of the week. Come on. How many of you hear me? How many of you been blessed by the word today? Yes. How many of you know you can't get blessed if you're not going to be generous, saints? $500. Who wants to give five? Let me see your hand. Hold your hand up. $500. Let me see your hand. Want to give $500? Anybody? Who? $500. My God. What in the world? Well, we're going to call it and cancel the convention this year. That's the best thing we can do. That's what we need to do. Just cancel it. How do you agree with that? How do you say, that's a good idea, Bishop? Come on. How many of you know, saints, it can't work this way? You got to be generous. Now, how many of you, you're 500? Okay, anybody else? I need you to hear me. I need to do this to move on. There's another one. There's two. There's three. Who else? Who else? I see that way over there. Four. All right, okay, there's four. Okay, who else? Okay. Now, some of you, you know what bothers me? When you make big money, I know some of you what you make in salary. And then you can't be generous with God? That bothers me. So I urge you to listen to me today. Let me ask you this. How many of you will give $200? Let me see your hands. $200. Put your hands up. I'm going to ask you to hold it up so I can take that in right now. Okay. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. What's wrong with this group up here? Jesus. Okay, what was that, 14? Okay, what's my number? 9,800. Okay, we're close. Now, how many of you can give $100? I need to see as many hands as possible because I know you can. Let me see your hands. $100. $100. Take us over the edge. Come on. Take us over the edge. Come on. I'm going to wait for you. Just take us over the edge. Some of you, I know that you make enough money you could be generous, saints. See, that's why I don't want to do this next week during convention. Hold your hand up. Let me see your hand. $100. Come on. This is your time. This is your time. You got a big job now. You're big time, so you better be giving $100. Okay. Okay. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. Okay, that's 20. We need 200 more. Okay, you're gonna do the other two? All right, she's got it. 200 more. That did it. Okay, No, it's not next month. We got to do it this week for the. But next month, come on and give it, because there'll be needs then, plenty of needs. Come on, how do you hear this? Now, how many of you gave? Would you put your hand up? Okay. Now, I'm going to pray for you. Hold it up. Father, in Jesus' name. And if children raise their hands, folks, I don't take children, so you have to be the adult. I have to do it that way. Father, you see the hands of your people. Now, Lord, teach us something here today. That God, we're never going to be the church that changes the nation and the culture until we get the message of how blessed it is to give. We hold on, and then we get bills. If we'd realize you are Jehovah Jireh, you want to bless us. You'll provide for us. You'll give us what we need. Father, thank you for every hand that's been put up to those that gave. I bless them. May they do it now. And we're going to sing a song, so I need you to give it now. I need you to get the envelope, get your check, get whatever you got to do, and let's bring it down. We're going to worship the Lord. I want you to do it now. In Jesus' name, look at me. Saints, you wouldn't want my job. See, I stand up here and I preach, tell you jokes, get you laughing, get you to the altar to get saved, get you delivered, and then I got to stand up here and take the offering and become your enemy. How do you know? You got to change up here. Saints, you're never going to break out of where you're at unless you change. Father, break the spirit of poverty off the church. Break the spirit of poverty off the church. We want healing. We get healed in church. We get delivered in church. We get saved in church. But then we can't give. God, forgive us and change us in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Will you look at somebody, smile at them, and tell them this has been good today? Come on, Esther. Come on, Esther.
My trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you will call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you will call. The presence of my Savior. stronger.